know, it is sad when you put more people on the prayer list than are coming off. But you know what? God's arm is not short. God is still in the miracle working, prayer answering business. And I believe it's a lot of work God does on that prayer list that we just ain't even aware of. God is working in people's lives like you can't understand, like you can't believe. And you know, when I was listening to the music and both of the songs and all the testimony that was given, it brought to mind one of the most misquoted Bible verses I've ever heard in my life. And you know what it is? And now you've all heard this before. This is not what the Bible says, but this is what people tell you. God will never put more on you than you can handle. Right? That's what people say. That ain't what the Bible says. But anytime you got a problem, anytime you're feeling down, they say, oh, don't worry. God will never put more on you than you can handle. But that's not what the Bible says. So we need to read that this morning. And that ain't what I'm preaching about. But don't get, but God led me to tell you all this right here. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, because it does kind of go along with my sermon. 1 Corinthians, y'all got to turn it and write it down, read that whole chapter later, because 1 Corinthians chapter 10, well, what I'm preaching about is has a lot to do with that. But 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, it's where that misquoted piece of scripture comes from. God will never put more on you than you can handle, right? That's what people say. Let me tell you what God said. Verse 13 says, there has no temptation. And this ain't temptation like tempting you to do something. This word temptation means trial. There's no trial. There's no hardship. There's no obstacle that comes upon you that hasn't been experienced by every man, including Jesus Christ. He suffered and he faced every trial, every hardship, every terrible thing that you will ever face 10 times greater. Jesus faced it. That's why he came to earth. So he could say, I've been there where you are. I've experienced what you're experiencing. And I overcome. And since I overcome, you can overcome too. But it don't say God will never put more on you than you can handle. Let's go on to hear what it says here. It says, there is no trial taken you but such as is common to man, because God is faithful. God is faithful, who will not let you be tried above what you are able. And it does say that. But we always leave out this last part, which is very important. Unless with the trial, also a way to escape, so that you may bear. So that's what God says. God don't say, I won't put more on you than you can handle, because in my life, he's put more on me than I could ever handle. But he always showed me a way. He always showed me a way of escape. And let me tell you, that way of escape is my rock and my Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. He is the way. He's the way of escaping every trial that comes upon you. He's the answer to every problem you ever have. He is the escape. So God will put things upon you that you can't handle, but he will show you a way of escape. He will always give you a way out of that trial. And that way out is him. It's him. And what I'm going to preach about today is a bunch of people who were experiencing a bunch of trials. But before that, let me tell you about a little trial I went through on my vacation. And let me tell you one thing. When you're up in the mountains, do not trust Siri. Let me just tell you, if you take notes, write that down in your notes. If you're ever in the mountains, do not trust Siri. She will get you in trouble. Because let me tell you, we went up one day on our vacation. We went up to Roanoke and we messed around and said, well, we'll just take the parkway back to where we're staying, and it comes out right there. And so we got on the parkway and we rode. Yes, no bathrooms on the parkway. Just remember that when you go. If you drive a truck, put your had drama in your life, we found a way to get rid of the drama in your life. It's called Drama Mind. It'll take the drama completely out of your life. Everybody in the truck lost their drama because we was popping Drama Mind, people. Because our stomach was sick. There was no drama in the truck. But you know what? We were scared to death. We were looking down. Oh my gosh. And so we go down one mountain. And it's like, praise God, we made it. We made it to the bottom. Then we go on back up another mountain. But you know, it's a strange thing. We kept going. It was two things that was constant about this road and about this trip. There was a stream at the bottom. At first, you could barely see it down at the bottom. And that road followed that stream. And there's another thing. As long as this road was off in the mountain, there was this mountain with this funny-shaped rock. And no matter where we were on that road, you could see that rock on top of that mountain. No matter where we were. And as we went up and down, and Christy said, Lord, I hope we don't meet a car on this road. And it won't, 5 seconds, here comes a car. And the car was on the mountainside, and we was on the edge side. And I said, I'm not moving. So I just stopped the car, and my truck, I was in my truck, which ain't exactly little. And so that car made it by with about that much to spare. And so we kept going. And I mean, what looked to be a shortcut was the long cut. But it was very scenic. And to me, it was the best part of the trip because they were scared to death. I was a little nervous up there, looking down with no guard on. We finally made it to the end, and there's that mountain right there. And that big old funny shaped rock looked like a shark's tooth up there. Y'all probably seen it before if you've been around that area. But anyway, we got to the end, and we said, whoo, thank you, Jesus. We was getting ready to get out and kiss the ground and stuff. And Lucas said, Daddy, look back right there. He done turned around in the seat looking back down the road. He said, look at that sign right there. What does that mean? I said, what are you talking about? He said, turn around and look. And the sign said, do not follow GPS down this road. I was overcome by the beauty of the mountain, but let me tell you. So I ask you this morning, have you ever been down what seemed like a dead end road?
Amen.
With no end in sight. That's the way some people's lives are. I'm going to talk to you this morning very quickly about a group of people in Exodus. It's Exodus chapter 17. And it's right around verse 10 there. We're going to start in verse 1, I guess. We'll just start at the very beginning of Exodus chapter 17. I want to talk to you about a group of people that was on a dead end road. No end in sight. They were going through a hard time in their lives, and I bet that there were some people there that was telling them the whole time, don't worry, God will never put more on us than we can handle. And I bet they didn't appreciate it one bit. Because they was in a tough spot. They were in a bad place in their life. Anybody here been in a bad place in your life?
Yeah.
Yes, Lord. Well, that's what we're going to talk about today. But one thing was constant, was that rock. They had a rock in their lives. And that rock brought them escape. We're going to talk about that this morning. Chapter 17 of Exodus says, and all the children of the congregation of Israel journeyed from the wilderness of Sin after their journey according to the commandment of the Lord and pitched in Rephidim, and there was no water for the people to drink. Wherefore the people did chide with Moses. This word chide means argue, murmur, grumble, gripe, complain. These people grumbled, gripe, complained, backbit Moses and said, give us water that we may drink. And Moses said unto them, why do you grumble with me? Why do you try God? And the people thirsted there for water, and the people griped and complained and murmured again against Moses and said, wherefore is it that thou hast brought us up out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our cattle with thirst? And verse 4 is the turning point. And Moses cried unto the Lord, saying, What shall I do with this people? They be almost ready to stone me. And the Lord said unto Moses, Go on before the people, and take thee with the elders of Israel, and thy rod, wherewith thou smotest the river. This is the same rod he smote the river with during the great plagues, and turned that river to blood. He said, Take that same rod, and that thou smotest the river, take in thy hand and go. Verse 6 says, And behold, I will stand before thee there upon the rock in Horeb, and thou shalt smite the rock, and there shall come water out of it, and that the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel, and he called the name of the place Massah and Meribah, because of the grumbling of the children of Israel, because they tried the Lord, saying, Is the Lord among us or not? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, we thank you for this day. Lord, it's hard to do, but I thank you for the trials that you put in our lives. I thank you because you tell us to thank you when stuff like that comes around. And if we thank you, you're able to bless us, Lord, and you're more able to provide us with a means of escape, Lord. Father, I know that not every trial is made to have an escape, Lord. You try us and mold us and make us into usable people for your glory, Father. And trials and tests are what helps us grow, Lord. But there are some that we need a way out of. And you provide that way. You provided it, Lord God, with your Son, Jesus Christ, as he hung on that cross, Lord. He is our rock. He's a spiritual rock. We find in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, where we just read it part of it. He's the spiritual rock that all of the Israelites drank of in that wilderness. Lord, he's the spiritual rock that we can drink of today to give our souls nourishment, Lord, to give our bodies rest, to give our hearts peace. Lord, I pray you would speak to us today, Lord, from your word, and I pray you would speak through me. I pray, Lord God, that you would just totally control me, Lord, and just take my tongue and use it to say the words that you want to be said today, Lord. Clear our minds of any thoughts that we have except about you, Lord. Give our minds rest and open them up, both our hearts and our minds and our ears, to receive the message you have for us today. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Yes, they were in a bad place, and they're like, you ever heard anybody say that? I'm in a bad place right now. Just leave me alone. I'm in a bad place. I just need to be left alone. They were in a bad place. They were out there. Where were they exactly? It says they were in the wilderness of sin. Now, I can't think of a worse place to be than in the wilderness of sin. And you know what? Some of God's children find themselves in the wilderness of sin. They've strayed away from God's grace and God's love, and they've strayed into the wilderness of sin. And they're in a bad place. Some people don't get there on account of doing bad things. Some people get there on accident. They didn't know what was going on. The devil duped them. The devil tricked them. But it don't matter. If you find yourself in the wilderness of sin, you got to get out of there. You got to find a way of escape, because it's a dry place. Is your spiritual life with Jesus a dry place like a desert? Or is it blooming like an oasis? Well, these people were in a bad place. They were in a dry place. And let me tell you, they were broken. These people were broken. God had drawn them out into a place, and he broke them. They were broken people. Have you ever felt broken in your life? I've been broken. I know how it feels to be broken. They had nowhere to turn. Yes, they were tired. They were tired of the journey they were on. I know there are people here right now that are tired of the journey that God has you on. Let me tell you, don't give up. God has a way of escape. There is a spiritual rock that is available to you this morning. Do you believe it? Shout amen.
Amen.
If you do. Yes, Lord. It's a bad place that they were in. But let me tell you something. We read here in verse 1, children of the congregation of Israel, they journeyed to the wilderness, seeing after their journeys. And then, if you write in your Bibles, underline these next couple words right here. According to the commandments of the Lord. What? They were in a bad place in their life, and guess who put them there? God put them there. The path they were on was a bad place. and be broken. Oh, it's my prayer that you would fall upon that rock and be broken instead of letting that rock fall upon you and crush you. Because he'll do it. He took them out there in the wilderness to test them. And this word here for trial in Hebrew is the same word that they used for testing armor back in the old days. If you had a piece of armor and you were getting ready to go out to battle, well, guess what? You wanted to test that armor out and make sure it would take a spear or a dart or whatever. And you got to test it. You got to see if that armor is what it's made out of. It's like them tomato plants that we get this time of year. And they about this tall, ain't they? You get some big ones. How in the world they get them that tall? Well, they put them in a greenhouse. And they started them way back in probably January, February or something. And you know how April is, end of April, when you say, well, I'm just going to go ahead and plant them tomato plants. It's big. It looks good. Oh, my gosh. And then it gets down one night about 30, and you don't put a bucket over it. Well, what happens to that big old nice tomato plant? It's like, it's gone. It's wilted. It's bowed down. Why? Because that, the first time that tomato plant ever got tested was that night. You see, but if you sow seeds in a plant bed and you raise them tomatoes up and as they come up out the ground, they get a little taste of cold and it might burn them a little bit, but they keep growing and then more leaves come out and there'll come another cold patch and it might burn a few leaves on them. But then when the real cold comes, that tomato plant is tested and tried because it's been through the cold and it can stand it again, and therefore that cold does not have an effect on that tomato plant. You know what? God's got a bunch of hothouse tomatoes. God's got a bunch of hothouse tomatoes. Oh, we up in church. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Praising God. And then one little bad thing happens. We grumbling, murmuring. Hey, God don't care about me. He ain't worried about me. He's got bigger things than me. Hey, he ain't never going to answer my prayers. You a hothouse tomato. Once a little trial comes upon you, you just fold over like that old tomato. But see, God takes his people and he tests them sometimes. That's what he's doing for these Israelites. He put them out in a dry place. So he said, if they can survive when it's dry, when I shall come and water them, they will blossom fully. And let me tell you, God's got an outpouring for his people coming where we will blossom. It don't matter about the trials you've been through. They're going to make you stronger. And God's got something for you. He's got a rock that's going to sprout forth living water. And he's going to rise you up. He's going to bring you up. And I got so much I want to say. And that clock right there is my worst enemy. So I'm going to have to think very carefully about what I say here in the next few minutes. I think I'm going to talk about that rock. I think I'm going to talk about that rock. See what the Bible says about that rock. It says in verse 6, Exodus chapter 17, behold, I will stand before thee there upon the rock in Horeb, and thou shalt smite that rock, and there shall come water out of it. Now, what do you think? Let's just take our minds on a little imaginary trip here. Just imagine if rocks could talk, because they might be able to. Jesus said, if we don't praise him, then the rocks will cry out. So it's possible that the rocks can talk if we don't start doing a little better job praising God. So won't you start right now? Praise God. Amen. Yes, Lord. Praise God up in this house. I don't want no rock out praising me, but I can just imagine being a rock out in the wilderness, and that rock had been there. Then just a little rock, and he's going to smote or smite or smote it. I don't know the proper grammar, but he's going to hit that rock, and water's going to come out of it. What do you think it's like to be that rock right there? I thought about that. What would it be like to be that rock? Now, at the time, that rock had probably been there a long time, hadn't it? That rock had just been sitting there. But probably other rocks around it, there's a whole lot more prettier than him. Because some rocks, you learn, are beautiful stones, and some rocks are coals. If you're into masonry, you understand that some rocks have a face and they're beautiful, and some rocks are coals. They don't have a face, they're unusable. And this poor little rock had probably been there, depending on if you were one of them evolutionist people that think we come from monkeys, then you probably think that rock They've been there for millions of years. But if you believe the Bible like I do and understand the world can't be no more than 7,000 years old because I believe what the Bible says, then that rock had to have been there for nigh on 5,000 years. Just laying there, nothing. Prettier rocks was probably all around him saying, boy, you ain't going to never amount to nothing. Just look at you. We're up here above you. We're prettier. We're taller. We're higher than you. You ain't never going to amount to nothing. And that poor little rock is just sitting right there. Sitting right there, taking all the abuse, taking all the punishment. Oh, yeah. Yeah, but you know what? Thing about it is this rock right here. This little rock was God's appointed rock. This was God's appointed rock. I wish you would turn to your neighbor and say, you are appointed by God. Because you know that? You are appointed by God. Just like that little rock was. You are appointed by God. God had a plan for that little rock's life. And I know rocks are not living creatures. I understand that. Bear with me. I'm just a simple old country boy trying to talk about rocks. But that little rock was right there. From the beginning of eternity. Won't amount to nothing. But see, in the mind of God, he knew that rock had a purpose. And it was a great purpose. God had appointed the purpose of that rock from before the foundation of the universe. You see, you're appointed, Jim. Do you know that? You're appointed. You are an appointed child of God. Tell me you're appointed. And I believe that you're appointed by God to do great things in this world. He has appointed you to be his child. And hey, don't let the other rocks look at you and say, man, you ain't going to amount to nothing. When they tell you that, you say, hey, well, wait a minute. I'm appointed by God. It ain't revealed yet what God's going to use me for and what all the good things God's going to do with me and through me. And he's going to make great things happen in my life because I believe that I am appointed. Do you believe that this morning? Or was you just telling your neighbor something to appease the preacher? Either way, maybe you'll believe it on the way home. It'll be all right. Let me tell you something else about that rock. Not only was that rock appointed, but that rock was anointed. Now you know what I want you to do now, don't you? What do y'all think I want you to do now? Yeah, Noah's got a good idea. Y'all turn to your neighbor and say, I am anointed. But then that was good, but I don't believe you. I don't believe you believe it. I want you to shout it out. I believe you are anointed. I believe everybody in here is anointed with God if you're saved by the blood of Jesus. I believe he has an anointing for you to walk in. I believe he's got something that only you can do. Nobody else can do it but you. There's nobody on the face of this earth that can do it except for you. Oh, I feel sorry for that little rock. He was sitting there. He was getting all kinds of abuse and punishment from them big old pretty nice rocks. Oh, but you know what? When Jesus come, or when Moses was sent by Jesus and he come and he smoked that rock, then everybody knew, wow, that ain't no regular rock. That's a special rock right there. All this time, we thought he was nothing, nobody. But you know what? God has an appointed time. Boy, we struggle with that one, don't we? God has an appointed time to raise you up. He's got an appointed time. What did Ruth say? Hey, for a time such as this, amen? For a time such as this, I believe God created you and God's got you here for a time such as this. Do you believe that?
Yes.
Man, I hope you do because I believe it for you. For a time such as this. And you know what? I don't know if Jake talked about this or not, but I will tell you this. You know, that's another one in verses where we just hear about that one part. For a time such as this. But you know what else he said? He said, because if you don't do it, God's going to raise up somebody else. If we don't do it, the rocks will cry out. If you don't walk in your anointing, God's going to raise somebody else up to do it. If you don't do it, you're going to going to lose it. What's the old saying? If you don't use it, you're going to lose it. God's given you that anointing. You've got to walk in it. You've got to be that rock for Jesus. And let Jesus be that rock for you. Because let me tell you, that little rock was really a symbol of Jesus. That little rock was a symbol of Jesus Christ. Because what happened to that rock? That rock at the right time was raised up. And he didn't look like nothing much. The Bible says he was comely and had no appearance that we should seek after him. That's what Isaiah said of Jesus. And that word comeliness, you know, that's a polite way of saying he's kind of ugly. He wasn't good looking. It's what the Bible says. He was nothing to look at that we would give him our attention. But at the right time, God raised him up. And then what happened? He come from nothing, out of nowhere. A poor old country boy up in his hometown. A carpenter, woodworker, probably stonemason. And amount to nothing. But at the right time, God raised him up. He was appointed from the foundation of the earth. He was anointed for his job. And then at the right time, he was raised up. But what happened? He was smitten. He was smoked. He was struck down for something he did not do. And it's out of that striking down that the blood and the water flowed from Calvary's cross. It's through that awesome cross of Jesus. Oh, that spiritual rock in 1 Corinthians 10:4 it says, and we all drink from that same spiritual rock that Moses and the Israelites drank from that day. That wasn't no regular rock. That was Jesus. That was the living water that was springing forth from that rock. And let me tell you, I don't care what you are going through today. You're right. God won't put more on you than you can handle unless he shows you a way of escape. That way of escape is the rock. That rock. That spiritual rock that pours out living water. He's our rock, he's my rock, he's your rock, and he is available today as a way of escape. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your grace and your love and your mercy, Lord. Pour it all out upon us today, Lord. Forgive us for our sins. Cleanse us with the blood of Jesus. Help us realize we are not only appointed, but we are anointed. And we might have to be smitten a time or two in order to be molded and made into the instruments that you would have us to be. Help us not to be hothouse lilies for you, Lord. Help us to be strong people of God, Lord. Use us today in Jesus' name. Amen.